back. I call this meeting of the Central Florida Facilitators Toastmasters Club 9958 to order. Thank you all for being here tonight. If you have phones or other electronic devices that make noise, please put them on silent mode now. We've got a couple guests this evening. Fantastic, great way to start the year. And that means we'll give you restroom instruction. People will be up here speaking. So if you need to use the restroom, just take a gander at that last door back there. You'll go out that door and take an immediate left, and then an immediate left, and down that hallway is the bathroom. You won't miss it. At Toastmasters, we provide a supportive and positive learning experience in which members are empowered to develop communication and leadership skills, resulting in greater self-confidence and personal growth. Through this mission, each Toastmaster gains a clear understanding of the club's purpose, and the organization as a whole benefits from a shared set of values and goals. Please help me welcome our thought and pledge leader for this evening, in multiple roles tonight, Jonathan Dunn. I spent a lot of time over the holiday season reading Wayne Dyer. He's one of my favorites. And I came across this quote from the late Wayne Dyer, God rest his soul. I really liked it. Here it is. You have to quit blaming others for how your life has turned out. Blaming others makes you a slave and removes your own personal power to go beyond. Please stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I've been really excited to do this. During the break, please put your hands together for our brand new president, Mark Lockery.
Central Florida Facilitators Toastmasters Club 9958. Woo-hoo! We are called the Facilitators for three reasons. We are sponsored by the Central Florida Chapter of the American Society of Training and Development, the premier organization for professional facilitators, open to all. A good facilitator needs to be a strong communicator and an effective leader, and Toastmasters is all about communication and leadership. Facilitate means to make things easy and possible, and we want to make things as easy and possible for you guys here tonight. I see we have a couple guests in our midst, so at this time I'm going to call on Jason, if you could just stand up and give us a quick introduction on you and how you found us.
Hi everybody, I'm Jason Zell. I found Toastmasters Club online. I've been to Toastmasters before on Lake Mary. I recently moved to Orlando and wanted to get back in, and I found out this club is great, so I wanted to join. I'm in medical sales, so speaking in front of other small groups, large groups, something what I do. But we can always get better. I want to move into leadership, so communication, the more I do it, the better you get. And that's why I joined to come and meet you all.
I'm glad that you made it out tonight, Jason. And Jack, if you could stand up and give us a quick introduction on yourself.
Just call me E.T. I had a good life. Started out as a junk man as a kid, so my dad did. Turned into trucking, racing, several other things that I really love to do. I've always liked to talk. Got a lot of stories. And my friend Tim here said, E.T., you need to come to Toastmasters. You'll enjoy this. You'll learn from it. And so I'm proud to be here.
All right. Well, you're definitely in the right spot for talking and stories. And there will be times in this meeting that you guys will have an opportunity to participate. Feel free to participate if you want, if you're comfortable. If not, just sit back and enjoy the rest of the talking and the stories that are going to go on. Real quick, before we get started, We have some pre-programmed business I just want to mention. We have officer training this Saturday at Cavalry Assembly. Are there any officers here who are not going to make it on Saturday?
Tim, you won't be?
I'm working weekends for the next 6 months.
Okay. I don't know when the makeup sessions are.
That's going to be on the
weekend. They haven't scheduled them yet.
Yeah, okay.
If it isn't a weekend break, if it is.
We'll cross that bridge.
We'll figure it out.
All right, as we progress through the meeting tonight, make sure you guys keep notes and be prepared to vote for the evening's most improved Toastmaster of the week. This will be the most improved Toastmaster, the first one for 2016. Our Toastmaster tonight is happy to be back amongst friends here at the Facilitators. And excited for the possibilities that 2016 and beyond bring. He's also excited to bring you a method of resolution setting that will help you on a path to becoming the best version of yourself. Please welcome tonight's Toastmaster, Jonathan Charlie Dunn.
That was an honor to meet you, Charlie.
Everybody, once again, excited to be up here tonight, excited that you're all here, excited that we have some guests. Excited to have a guest that I had a connection with, slightly. Let's talk about agenda changes first. It looked like there was going to be a lot, but in true facilitator fashion, a lot of people came through. So the one that we have is that Sarah is going to take the second evaluator position, which was previously going to be a dual role by Mark Lockery. Otherwise, everything is completely set. I didn't miss anything, did I, Mark? No. And before I get into the topic of tonight's meeting, let's meet the people that behind the scenes this evening are going to be making this meeting possible. So, would our timer, Susan Morgan, please stand up and share with us what you're going to do this evening.
One of the skills Toastmasters practice is expressing a thought within a specific time. As timer, I'll be responsible for monitoring time for each speaker in each meeting segment. I will operate the timing lights, which are here, and will indicate how long they've been speaking. For our prepared speeches, to qualify for voting, speakers must speak no less than 30 seconds under their range minimum and not more than 30 seconds over their range maximum. Let me ask really quick, Jay, you're 8 to 10?
Yep.
And Tony, are you 8 to 10 as well?
Sounds good.
Okay. And Stephen, are you doing 5 to 7 or?
Yes, I'll fit there.
You'll fit there? Okay. For our table topics, you must speak at least 1 minute and no more than 2 minutes, 30 seconds. And for our evaluations, you have 2 to 3 minutes. At 2 minutes, you'll get the green light, and the yellow light will come at 2.5, and the red light at 3. You must not speak more than 3 minutes and 30 seconds, or you will not qualify for voting. And that's what I'll be doing, is monitoring time.
Thank you, Madam Timer. Next, let's meet one of my favorite people in the world, our grammarian, Roy Witt. Roy?
Thank you, Jonathan. As grammarian, I've chosen the word of the day, or somebody chose it for me, which is nostalgic. I'll keep track of those who use the word of the day for Clubs of the Fine, which we are. Those who have a chance to speak and do not use the word of the day will be fined 25 cents. Guests and members who have not yet given their icebreaker speech will not be fined. I will also listen for colorful imagery and exceptional use of vocabulary and grammar. At the end of the meeting, I will report on grammar usage and suggest where I see improvements can be made. Mr. Toastmaster.
Roy, do you have a definition for nostalgic?
I don't have one readily available.
I mean, everybody in the room probably knows what
it is. I know what it is, but I don't have it.
Would you like to use it in a sentence?
I am nostalgic of the days of playing football out in the backyard in the sandlot.
Looking fun. As I nostalgically reflect on 2015.
I nostalgically think about my life. I live in nostalgia. Okay, thank you, Roy. Well done being on the spot, too, as always. Next, in a dual role in gunning for the Chastain Award tonight, our A-counter and supervisor of elections, Miss Emma Hancock.
For the rest of the semester, because I do not believe unless something happens to my classes that I am going to become this to the commanding chair for the rest of the semester. So I'm sorry about that, everybody. You probably won't be saying me much.
No.
So I'm going to start with the A-counter first.
Either one, Emma.
Okay. So my job as A-counter is to keep track of audible clutches, such as double clutches, which is the repetition of a word like. And I will also note sentences strung together with bridge words such as and or so, and I'll sound the buzzer possibly if I am not too distracted with other things, and you will be hearing this. Maybe. I fine each infraction for 10 cents. And guests and members who have not yet done their icebreaker will not be buzzed or fined, but I will keep track of it. And for the supervisor of elections, as you like to now call it, because you guys changed names on me, I will pick up your ballots for best speaker, best table topic speaker, best evaluator, and most approved speaker. I will tally these results for the award presentations at the end of the meeting. I also pick up any comments you might have written for the speakers or any meeting participant and deliver the comments to the appropriate person.
Thank you, Emma. Thank you for taking two roles. And now to the topic of the meeting before we get into the speakers, the right resolutions. Most of you know by now I own a gym. It's a very big time of the year for me. This and summer. And over the 15 years I've really been in the gym industry, on my gym, I have seen a crazy amount of failures when it comes to setting New Year's resolution. Probably more than most people. So much so that I started looking up statistics on it. And I mean, I'm always fascinated by how they even come up with some of these statistics. Makes me think there might be a little BS involved. But most people, the average is people try less than one time before giving up. And the reason it can be less than one, if 10 people set resolutions, really only one of the people ends up even trying at all. And that's why it's such a low percentage. And thus I went out and I started researching why people fail so bad at resolutions and came up with, of course it's my point of view, what the right resolutions are. So by a show of hands, and you're not gonna be asked to go into what they are, how many of you set New Year's resolutions for 2016? So good, I mean, I appreciate the honesty, that's about what I forgot. So, by a show of hands, and this is gonna take a great deal of honesty, how many of you are so sick of failing at your resolutions that you don't even bother setting them any longer at all?
I have another philosophy. I think you should have resolutions every day. You should live every day with trying to improve and trying to be better. It shouldn't be something you do on January 1st of each year as the only day you do it. It should be something you think about all the time.
I happen to agree with you, by the way, Jay, I do, believe it or not. I'm dead on with you. So there's a lot of people that don't even bother.
Yeah.
If you listen to what I have to say tonight, and you take this advice, and you follow through with it, all lofty things, I can absolutely promise you, speaking from experience, that 1 year from now, even a week from now, your life will be way better. And as you're sitting there in 2016, just understand that you're meant to be a happy person. You're meant to be happy every day. And that's what these are gonna be geared for. And then some advice, and we're not gonna get into them until later segments, one of the reasons people fail at their resolutions is they don't take them seriously. And if you make a resolution, and like Jace even saying, doing every day like I do, whatever I say I'm going to do, and it's, you got to place it at the center of your life. You got to place little reminders all over the house, in your car, at your office. You got to make your resolution serious. You got to place them at the center of your life. And then you got to write them down. There's a lot of ideas that go bouncing around in our head, and that's why they bounce, because as you get, you know, even Emma, I'm not even sure how young she is, but a lot of stuff starts happening, and it's quick for things to get pushed into the back. So you got to write them down. And you need to have true friends, not fake friends, like Facebook kind. Not that some of the Facebook people aren't legitimately friends, but people that will be a command and control and hold you accountable. Because the true friends will help in a loving fashion hold you accountable for what you say you're going to do. Your true friends will encourage you to be first rate. Your not true friends will let you be second rate. Reminders. When we get back into this, because we're getting ready to go into my favorite part of the meeting, which is the prepared speeches, there's going to be four categories that you're going to want to think about setting them in. But more on that later. Speakers, are you ready?
Yes.
Good. I told, I didn't get a chance to talk to our second guest, but our first guest, I told him, I live in downtown Orlando, but I drive to this club. This club's well worth it. It's a great club. I'm glad you're going to see why. Our first speaker today will reflect on her experiences of 2015. She will tell us about lessons she learned that have changed aspects of her life for the better. She hopes to lift your spirit and encourage you to consider how the lessons she learned might benefit you, your relationships, and your life. Please welcome Jay Majors.
Good evening, fellow Toastmasters and our honored guests. It's wonderful to be here, and Happy New Year to everyone. In my last speech, I told you the story of the greatest moments of my life up to the recent wedding of my amazing daughter. As I nostalgically reflect on my experiences of 2015, my thoughts are of joy, love, family, friends, and relationships. It was one of the best years of my life. Today, I want to tell you about some of the lessons I learned, why it was a year of personal growth, and how my approach to life and relationships evolved. Some of you may have discovered that I'm not shy about sharing my opinions and thoughts. I tell it like it is, or at least how I see it. And my thoughts don't always come out in the best way or at the best time. The first lesson may have been the toughest for me, and it actually started to hit me before my daughter was engaged. After 8 years of dating and almost a year during that time of living together, which you can imagine didn't sit well with me, it was long past time for the next step to happen for Heather and Matt. My family, my friends, and Heather's friends were all voicing their opinions and their two cents. The comments ranged from, "When are you guys getting married?" to "Tell him to psh, or get off the pot," to "Dump him and move on," and worse. You get the idea. Everybody had their views. I agreed with the voices, and it was frustrating, but it was even worse for my daughter. How could I could see and feel her pain. I was determined not to cause her more pain. I had to find a way to help without making things worse. No matter what my thoughts were, I had to help. This is my biggest challenge, giving guidance to my daughter without crossing the line. How could I help both of them to the next decision, to get engaged or walk away without interfering or poisoning their relationship or my relationship with both of them? I swallowed my tongue and my words about 1,000 times before and after the engagement, but I learned to give guidance and support with love, to shut up and give my 2 cents when asked. I let them make their own decisions. Learning this lesson changed my relationship with my new son and made my relationship with my daughter even stronger, if you, that was even possible. The next lesson has to do with decisions and actions. The engagement almost didn't happen. By the time Matt decided it was time and took action, Heather was on the verge of walking away. This is what we were dealing with. He realized that he almost lost her because of the lack of action and commitment. It was frustrating and extremely stressful. They both had to forgive and understand. Matt learned that decisions and actions have a lot to do with timing. Moving forward, I knew they had to make a lot of decisions if the wedding was going to happen in 6 months. It was hard for me, the consummate doer, to sit back and let the process happen. Matt makes good decisions, but he takes forever figuring it out, investigating, and making sure. Remember, they dated for 8 years. Heather also makes good decisions as long as the choices are limited. This is making me crazy. Getting Matt to move quicker and narrowing the choices for my daughter. They're also good compromisers, but remember, decisions take longer when compromise is involved. He wanted to be the man in control of the process, but he had no clue where to begin. They knew that the first decision had to be the venue. I suggested they talk to a close friend of mine at Heathrow Country Club. I knew she would be a wealth of information and knowledge for them. She made the venue choice easy and made it possible for the planning process to move forward. After that, Matt loosened up and became more open to suggestions and assistance. They actually asked me to go along with them for all the other planning decisions and choices. I made it my mission to give pro and con suggestions and supportively agreed with both of them and let them make their decisions. And believe me, it wasn't always easy. They gained confidence in their decisions and comfort from taking action. They learned to accept guidance, and Matt stepped back, letting Heather take charge. It was so cool to see how they grew together and how their different lives came together. I had to keep everything on track, and I had done so. Everything was on time, and everything was exactly as they wanted. He realized I was there to help, and it was out of love. They learned about decision making and taking action. We all learned to trust the process and let go. I learned to take more time and allow things to unfold. This has been an amazing area for my personal growth. While the kids were developing decision making skills, I was doing my super mom thing. After about 6 months of being a total whirling dervish, I realized I was on overload. I needed 3 of me, and that was not going to happen. As a doer, I have a hard time asking for help. I'm the one that jumps in for everybody else. I had to be there for my daughter, and her wedding had to be perfect. Realizing this, it became easy to accept and even ask for help. I learned not to underestimate friends and family, people that care about you. They're looking for the opportunity to help. They want to be there. They want to be a part of your life. Our friends were there out of love. Their actions were above and beyond anything we could have asked for. The final details came together because they helped make it happen. It was perfect, and our friends were delighted to be a part of it. I learned strong people realize when they need help, and smart people ask for it. The last and most important lesson has to do with the heart. Matt and I were growing closer. As the process unfolded, he could see how much I gave to help with making sure it was all about their wishes and their life. He finally understood why Heather's relationship and bond with me was so strong. He never had that loving, giving, supportive relationship with his parents or with his siblings. I was there for them while his parents seemed to disengage as the weeks passed. When Matt needed their support, they were unavailable and even contrary. Not to mention the fact that their support would have helped the stress level for all of us. I felt sad for Matt. He deserved and needed their reassurance and their support. Their lack of support was negative to Matt and Heather's relationship. Eventually, they did start coming around. I did my best to make a difference, and it brought us closer. The love my daughter and I share poured out on him, and he had no choice but to respond. Yes, there were rough patches through the process and in the years before. Things were said and done. Things were not said and not done with unintentional consequences. There were small and not so small things that needed to be forgiven between all of us. The reality is the sweetest part of life is rooted in the heart. We all learned the difference that allowing your heart to lead your actions changes lives, changes relationships, and forgiveness starts in the heart. Looking back on 2015, I learned a lot about me, grew to be a better person and a better mom. I strengthened my bond and relationships with my daughter, with my new son, and all of my family and friends. These four lessons apply to all relationships, personal and business. In short, the lessons are guide and support without stepping in the middle. It's about the other person. Decisions precede action. Trust the process. Give it time. Let go and find compromise. Strong people ask for help when they need it. Other people care and they want to help. Accept it. The best gifts are love, time, and forgiveness. It's all about the heart. In life, everything is better when you engage your heart.
Madam Timer, might we have a minute on the clock? And we have guests. There should be a slip like this in front of you. If there's not, I think there's yours. Our speakers love feedback because we are here to become better speakers and better communicators. So please, in this minute, write down your feelings for Jay. Doesn't matter necessarily what they are, but what you felt, what you think she should work on, what she did good.
Is that a brief one?
Yes.
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 All right. Since her late 20s, for those of you that are keeping track, that would be the 1970s. If you are not good at math, Tony has been on a personal development journey. She has sought out books, tapes, courses from personal development leaders in the United States and is an avid fan of Oprah Winfrey's Super Soul Sunday interviews. In the 1980s, she trained and assisted classes with the Dale Carnegie team in Orlando, was a student of and a leader with Landmark Corporation, a worldwide training and transformational development company, and has been a Toastmaster, where she has mentored many members and been trained in leadership and communication for 11 years. A big part of her 35-year career in audiology was spent in continuing education, both taking and delivering courses on a national and international stage, completing yet another basic communication manual with speech number 10, Inspire Your Audience, speaking on the topic, The Greatest Gift of All. Please welcome distinguished Toastmaster, Tony Gittles.
How will you use your one precious, glorious, extraordinary life this year? Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters and guests, Happy New Year to all of you. I'm wondering what your New Year's resolutions are. I've been reflecting on a question. I'm quite nostalgic at the end of the year. How will I use my one precious, glorious, extraordinary life this year? This has been a year to 2015 of celebrating my 65th birthday, of fun, of some travel, and of great challenges with my health, my mother's health, and with this club. So the reflection has been to see what I could do better, to look at those areas where I was maybe struggling and where I might have caused a little conflict in the club. I realized there is a gift I can give, and a gift I can be open to receiving that would make all the difference in the world. One resolution, one gift. When I practiced it, and I have practiced it, it could make my life and the lives of those around me uplifting and even magical. The gift is, what is it, John? The gift of love. Love, Jay. Yeah.
Love, love.
Next, I considered the question, what if I woke up every morning? Well, for me, sometimes it's like early afternoon. And my first thought was, how can I give and receive more love today? How can I put a little love in my life and in the world? How can I love and support my closest friends, the members of Central Florida's facilitators, and do this without being overbearing this time? Each and every one of you have taught me many, many valuable lessons this year and over the years. Even Jonathan David Dunn. Yes, some of you still have trouble with what you think is his egotistical know-it-all attitude. Friends, it's just a facade. We all have them. We put up walls in front of ourselves. And yes, in case you were wondering, I know you've heard the story about how I almost kicked Jonathan out of the club. Well, it's highly exaggerated, but factual. Many of you remember John's first day here in his first few weeks. He was obnoxious, loud, and he talked a lot during the meetings. He was disruptive. I was the president. Oh my God, I was the president. I couldn't stand it. My club, my professional club that I loved, and this disruptive person in the room. Oh God. I told Jonathan we have to have a talk. I spent a long weekend mulling over the conversation. I wanted to run away. I was going to resign as president. I called the other members and got their input. And then I remembered something Oprah Winfrey said. You learn the most about yourself in the moments of the greatest challenge. This conversation was going to be a challenge, but I wanted a really positive outcome. So let me remind you, you do not know a person's story until you talk to them and get to know him. And at this time, we did not know his story. We did not know he was a man hiding behind grief, his heart was broken, and he was struggling just to get through every day. From John, I learned patience. Oh, by the way, he's here. It was a successful conversation. And I was really proud of myself and how John started to shift his behavior. And, you know, he's still John. But I learned patience. I learned to talk to him and others and not run away from challenges. I wanted to make the world a better place. I learned to express my opinions and feelings, hopefully not in an overbearing way. Today I consider him one of my best and most favorite friends. We have had conversations about love, about our purpose in life, making the world a better place, helping people, my progress, not using notes for my speech, oops, and having more fun. Consider this. While Toastmasters is about public speaking and leadership, isn't this club really a microcosm of the real world? Aren't we a community? You walk through that door. We are a community. We are a universe. We are a reflection of what is going on in the outside world. We are an intelligent, creative group of people, and on occasion, there is disagreement and there is upset, just like any other place in our lives. I've been here over 11 years. I've seen the diversity in our membership, culture, religion, spirituality, even sexuality. Over the past 11 years, our members have been atheists, agnostics, spiritual people, Christians, Catholics, Jews, and I don't even know how many other. Our parents, our grandparents, and some of our members are immigrants. They're from Romania, Russia, Cuba, and other countries. And at least one of our former members grew up under communist rule. This is diversity. We've had several members, including one of our founders, who stood up during the Pledge of Allegiance and never said a word. We've had straights, gays, and bisexuals, single, married, divorced, and widowed people, parents, single parents, and people with no children. We have cat lovers, dog lovers, and remember, horse lovers. We have people experiencing struggles with health issues, divorce, addiction, and aging parents. Central Florida Facilitators can be and is a program about giving speeches and about learning leadership. Or for those of you, for those of us that choose a program that offers us a chance to practice human relations, friendships, and love. Fellow Toastmasters, the world isn't only outside that door. This is our world. Let's take on the challenge and live our Toastmaster lives boldly. This is a training ground. Let's be our best possible selves in here so we can go out that door and make a difference in the world. Let's be open to giving love and receiving love from each other. Let's work through our disagreements quickly and learn to get along. Yeah, there's a lot of personalities in here, I get it. Let's get through that. It's essential not just for the survival and health of our club, it's essential for the survival of the planet. I declare to you today, I'm opening my heart to receive your love. Bring it on! Let's work. And love is like a boomerang. I'm going to give it back to you, but I want to know what that looks like. For John, it's kiss and hug. Kissy huggy. For Gail, it's hug. It's hugs and gifts and parties and lots of other things. And coaching. Obviously coaching. How will I use my one precious, glorious, and extraordinary life this year? By utilizing the greatest gift I have. Let there be love in the world, and let it begin with me. Let us give and receive from each other the greatest gift of all. I invite you to make a resolution, whoever didn't, to join me in learning to express my New Year's resolution, to support me in being a better, kinder, more loving version of myself. I make you a promise to do the same for you. Mr. Toastmaster.
Madam Timer, might we have a minute on the clock? Please write down your comments for Tony. Thank you, Madam Timer. Who here knows Stephen? How do you really know him? Of course, you would know him as a 17-year Toastmaster. But do you know him as a software engineer? As a teacher? As a singer? Perhaps a hypnotist, a speech contest junkie. I do. Stephen is all of these. But now, let's look at him as a philosopher. Get ready to think things you have never thought before with Advanced Toastmaster Gold, Stephen Morgan.
Leave it out. I told you I was only going to do this for one reason. I decided to take the office, VP Public Relations, because, okay, this sounds silly, I just wanted to make the newsletter. And the reality is, it's not the newsletter that I want to make. The newsletter is the excuse for me to learn this program, publishing program. I need a reason, and here's my chance. I don't care about putting the club's notice in the newspaper. I'll send the email if that's what it takes. I don't want to make flyers. I'm not going to go around talking to businesses. I just have no interest. And as I explain this, the response that I get back is, "And you're not doing your job."
Yeah, that's right. Let me read those qualifications.
Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, our guests, that was the reason I took the office originally back in the fall of 2008. And that was all I focused on. And I made some nice newsletters. In fact, if you noticed, I had emailed some copies of them out this week. You can see them online. And it's fascinating to look back at those nostalgic times. But that conversation probably told you something about me and about the person I was talking to. But I'm also asking you, what would you be in that conversation? Would you have been in my spot? Would you have been in the other person's spot? And why? I'm here to talk about, and I'll be talking about this Saturday in much longer length, about the philosophies inside of Toastmasters. But for you to understand your own, there are three questions that I would ask you to answer. If you had time, I'd say go do the SurveyMonkey link, but I'm also going to go over them for us all to see. The first question is, what type of organization is Toastmasters? The second question you'll get to answer is, what are the core strengths of Toastmasters? And as you think about your answers to those, think about how they relate to your answer to what is the greatest value Toastmasters provides to you. So I'd like to hear a little bit about what you might think Toastmasters is, what type of an organization. Throw a few ideas out here, because I'm sure there's a few I'm going to hear.
Fraternal.
A fraternal organization.
Professional development.
Professional development.
Yeah, yeah, personal development is fine.
Personal development.
Sanctuary.
Sanctuary.
Confidence building.
Excellent one.
Training.
Training.
Communication and leadership.
All of them excellent answers. You're all wrong.
Yeah.
Because I'm the only one who had it right.
Volunteer.
Or perhaps there are many possible answers.
Hey, our answers are there.
Some of them are. But in that conversation you heard, which idea that I have Toastmasters was, which idea did the other person have? Because our ideas clearly did not mesh. I had the idea that what I was doing was for myself, and that's what I cared about. And the other person was saying I had to meet their standards. And their standards was, I'm not doing the job. They're thinking that this is like a job, maybe it's a profession. And I didn't want to fit in that. And because of that, we had conflict. Because we had different ideas of what the organization is supposed to be. Are any of these right or wrong? My supposition is that those differences are why we have difficulties within the clubs. And the struggles within our club, which we have seen Tony illustrate just for us, just her speech right there, were two conflicting ideas of what Toastmasters was supposed to be. A very common one that John got pulled into a lot is he walks in and gives a speech in jeans, and he gets chewed out by Charlie because he's not dressed professionally.
Yeah.
What does the dress matter? Okay, if I came up here naked, some of you may be a bit uncomfortable, But why should it matter if I'm wearing the tie, or if I have sneakers, or if I came in the yoga outfit, which we have seen members do as well? But for them is what worked for them. But what are the core strengths of Toastmasters? Anyone care to throw those out?
Community.
Okay.
Common interest.
Leadership.
Leadership. Where leaders are made, as they like to say. There are many possible ones. It's not just the communication and leadership that Toastmasters espouses. I see many more. And personally, I see different core strengths below those. And here are examples that may all be appropriate, depending on what you think Toastmasters is. But if you think what you see as Toastmasters is different from someone else, you are going to run into a problem. If somebody is coming in and they want to learn their management skills, someone else is coming in using it as a support group to be able to talk about their issues, you think there's going to be some conflict in there? Those are the problems we have. But when somebody walks into the room for the first time, what are they going to see? They're coming in with perhaps no idea, but they know they are looking for something. And it may be that they're looking for management skills. It may be they're looking for the support group. It may be they're looking for coaching or mentoring. How are you going to get that person to stay unless you give them what they want? And then the final question is, what is Toastmasters' greatest value? That is going to be up to you. I was only interested in the newsletter that term here for those 6 months. And that's pretty much all I did. Did I not do my job? Well, let me point out to you, in those 6 months, we managed to get both the advanced communicators turned in. We had 10 members join in 6 months. We had covered 7 of the DCP points in those 6 months alone. The club achieved its goals. I achieved my goal. What do you call that?
Success.
Success. Mr. Toastmaster.
Madam Timer, may we have 1 minute on the clock to write down your comments for Stephen? And as we are running a teeny bit behind schedule moving into our table topics, while you're writing, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to give you the first two areas that you should consider doing resolutions in. And you have to remember PIs. The first one is P, which stands for physical. And I think if I was to ask for a show of hands, everyone in the room would say, I would love to have more energy. But if that's not you, great. So thinking about physical and wanting more energy, starting today, you need to make a commitment. This is a very low-end commitment, Tony. You need to exercise once a week for an hour for 52 weeks straight, bare minimum. You do that, you will have more energy, and you will begin the process of treating your body like the temple that it is. You need to set a physical resolution. You get one body, that's it. And you don't want to have to go backwards once you've gotten older, fixing all the boneheaded things that you've done early on. Believe it. Give it a minute.
Right now.
Okay, well, I meant to give two. Intellectual. You need to set an intellectual resolution. You may disagree with me here, but if you look back through history, we become the stories that we see and the stories that we listen to. And thinking about Tony's personal development journey, I can't even imagine how many books she's read over the last 30 plus years. But I would encourage you to put down to read one book per month that inspires you, that expands your vision of yourself, because what you read, you will start to walk and talk. And I would also encourage you to quit playing in the sewer. And And if you think about what we used to watch on television in the 70s with Leave It to Beaver, and the stuff that was risque then compared to what they show now, and that we let our kids watch, nobody would let their kids play in the sewer, but watch what they watch on TV, and it's the same damn thing. You're letting them play in the sewer. And the music that get listened to? Sickening. Sickening. All right, I'm off my soapbox. So physical, intellectual. Tony missed something in all the people that she's come across in her Toastmasters journey, because our Table Topics Master this evening, he's famous. And he's also infamous. For those of you who don't know Roy, he has also set a resolution this year. He spent 20 years mentoring under Bernie Madoff. This is what happens when you
pay off.
Yes, when you don't write your own introduction and turn it in ahead of time. Roy, the financial advisor, spent 20 years mentoring under Bernie Madoff.
Okay, good.
And he finally decided this year, in 2016, he was going to turn over a new leaf and resolve himself to not listen to his tactics any longer. Please welcome our Table Topics Master, Roy Winning.
Thanks for that lesson on making sure I write my own introduction. So when Jonathan was giving his introduction this night, I thought I saw a hand go like this when he asked about New Year's resolutions. So to kick things off this evening, Susan Morgan, tell us about your 2016 New Year's resolution.
Thank you, Mr. Table Topics Master. My 2016 New Year's resolution started back in 2015 when I decided that it was time for me to lose some weight and to get some energy and to feel better about my physical body. And we started going to boot camp, working our butts off every week, once a week, and then we decided we would take the next step and do a personal training. So twice a week now, we go one to boot camp, one to personal one-on-one training with the coach, and we have lost weight, we've gotten more energy, and all those things. And we are, I've lost weight, and I'm really excited about losing more weight. The reason I said it was kind of half-half was because it didn't start just at January 1st. It started last year in like October, but it's continuing on this year. What my other New Year's resolutions will be, I'm not 100% sure yet. I'm still working on what goals I want to attain this year. But the biggest one was for the physical and becoming more healthy. Mr. Hayden.
Excellent. Resolutions, whether New Year's resolutions or just personal goals or pure determination, can be exciting and great source of motivation for us. Emma, tell us a success story about one of your New Year's resolutions or personal goals that you've accomplished.
It's one of those things I've tried to work on. It's one of those things that I've really tried to set goals and get.
Would you like to pick a question?
Same question.
Would you like to pick a question?
Yes, sir.
All right. If you definitively had the power, skills, knowledge, drive to accomplish whatever you set your mind to, what would it be?
I have to start with my parents. My dad worked hard, they were immigrants, but he drank and he gambled every night. Mom was the Irish woman that had the iron fist and all the right values. She taught me well. One thing we did, we worked. I wasn't especially smart as a kid. I struggled to make C's. Nobody in my family went to high school. My children. Now they've all got master's degrees, aren't you? In my case, but I was a worker, and I had a lot of energy, and I didn't know such thing as a challenge. My greatest thing, I came to things like this, I self-taught myself. I'm well-traveled, I'm well-read. I still to this day, I've never ever, only this moment, I hesitate not to keep a red binder and I write every thought down. Constantly going over things. I'm the ultimate follower person tackle some things in life. I put desire as a great equalizer on my desk because when I started the business myself with $1,600, I'm going to guess $20 million companies, $100 million companies. But I was a single person that would go in, drive that truck in myself, talk to these people, and I did not know that I still don't. In my life, I built a $4 million business. Our race cars have won 5 national championships. It didn't start easily. It took us 17 years to win our first major race. But then we were pretty good. I've always, when I listen to these things about this young lady here was talking about the making our resolutions, I've kind of lived my life in such a way that I'm living them constantly, every day. When it comes to the love, I practice it. When it comes to my walking, I walk an hour every day, I pick up the trash as I go. It's just part of making you feel better, making the world a better place to have. I get off on myself so much there that I probably just feel too much about it. But I love a challenge. If there's no challenges, honestly, I'm here. I'm 74. I'm trying to take care of me. I still want to learn. I still have a future. I don't know what I'm going to fix. But I might, even though I'm fairly my age, you get nostalgic.
You often remember these things.
But I'm also optimistic. And I enjoy being here.
Thank you very much to our guests for taking questions. It's awesome. Turn it back over to Jonathan Dunn.
Thank you very much. I erred earlier, I'm a little rusty. We need a timer's report for the speakers and the table topics, please.
All right. Start with our speakers. Jay was supposed to speak 8 to 10 minutes. She spoke 10 minutes and 15 seconds. She qualifies. Tony was also 8 to 10 minutes, and she spoke 9 minutes and 54 seconds, so she qualifies. Steven was 5 to 7 minutes, and he spoke 7 minutes and 27 seconds, so he also qualifies.
So please cast your vote for best speaker, which is part of that same slip that has the comments section. And Emma will come around and collect. Yep, she's here to do that one.
And then Emma will be around to collect those. For table topics this evening, I spoke about New Year's resolutions for 1 minute and 39 seconds, so I qualify. Emma spoke about not having New Year's resolutions for 1 minute and 34 seconds, so she qualifies. Jason talked about follow through for his resolutions for exactly 1 minute. He qualifies. And Jack, you spoke about a lot of stuff, so I'm just going to say you spoke for 2 minutes and 17 seconds, and you qualified.
Well done,
so
everybody.
So everybody qualifies for voting this evening.
And as you cast your votes, I'll give you the next two and the final two areas to consider for your New Year resolutions. Number 3 of PIES is E, which stands for an emotional resolution. Everybody wants to be happy. If you truly want to be happy and not hedonistic, there's a big difference. Big difference. Not that a little bit of hedonism now and then is a bad thing. But if you're part of a relationship or you want to be part of a relationship that's successful, you have to schedule at least one time per month away from your phone, away from your computer, engaged in what I refer to as carefree timelessness with whatever your most important relationships are. Carefree timelessness. And the last one, and I'll leave this a little open-ended, a spiritual resolution. And I'll leave it at this. When you were born, there was a dream for your life, and the dream for your life, which I don't think can be debated, was for you to become, and we've seen this theme come up time and time again, which was for you to become the best version of yourself. So when you think about your day-to-day decision-making process, if you get into the habit of asking yourself, is this decision I'm about to make going to lead me to becoming the best version of myself, you can weed out a lot of nonsense. So a physical resolution, a intellectual resolution, an emotional resolution, and a spiritual resolution that you write down, you make the center of your life, you set a command and control, you tell your friends, in your life. It'll be amazing. We are now moving in to the evaluation portion of our meeting. It's one of my favorites. Our general evaluator this evening, our very first, now he did write his own introduction, by the way. It has all of the telltale markings. Our very first general evaluator of the year, actually, is a man who just celebrated 2 years with the facilitators. Maya, how time flies. It's been a great bit of nostalgia with you, Lockery. He is considered by many to be a phenomenon, a force that is virtually unstoppable. Except during the 2014 District 84 Humor Speech Contest and the 2015 District Humor Speech Contest, where he regressed from 7th place to disqualified. But just like global warming alarmists, he refuses to go away quietly and vows that someday his hurricane force humor will bring home some hardware. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct honor and privilege to introduce you to our general evaluator this evening, Mark El Nino Lockery.
Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster. For the benefit of our guests, the evaluation portion of the meeting is where we kind of dissect the prepared speeches and give them constructive feedback, possible areas of improvement, things for them to consider when they give their next speech. Some might consider this a period of carefree timelessness. So, did somebody walk away with the book that was up here?
Mark, I stuck it right there.
Okay. We'll move right into our evaluators. For evaluator number one, this evaluator has been in Toastmasters for 8 years and loves Toastmasters because each day, every time, he learns something new. The other reason is he gets an opportunity to help others improve their speeches. So please help me welcome Charlie Bombalier, evaluating Jay Major.
Mr. General Evaluator, fellow Toastmasters, welcome guests, and especially Jay Majors. Life lessons from the mother of the bride. Talk about a nostalgic speech. It is clear that 2015 was a humbling experience for you, a learning experience of joy, love, relationships, forgiveness, patience, learning how to give guidance and support in a loving manner. All in one speech, that's awesome. We also learned from your own words that you're a very opinionated individual. Yet, you learned how to swallow your pride when it came to your daughter's happiness. This we all got clearly. Along with the passion that comes from your heart when you speak of the angel that you gave birth to. Having said that, I would like to give you a couple suggestions on the next time you do this speech, and I hope you do it again, because it's a great speech. How about enhancing your speech with a great big picture of your little angel and your new son? You talk so well of them, we almost feel like they're family here. We want to see what they look like. You gave a powerful speech on the love of your life, which was phenomenal. Those started with, "Good evening, ladies and gentlemen." Give us a powerful something that was going to wake us up and listen to what you have to say about the love of your life. Something like, "I want to agree with all the negatives I heard about my daughter." That'll get everyone standing up and paying attention to what you have to say. And since you were reading a lot, which I wish you get away from more because it's your own speech and your own family, you had a tendency to look to the right a lot more than you did to the left. Yeah, it was a heartfelt speech. And one asset you have is that you speak with passion and love. It is clear you have achieved love and forgiveness in 2015 and will carry it into 2016. Mr. General Evaluator.
Thank you, Charlie. Our next evaluator this evening is Sarah Hunt, who hails from 2 hours north of London, from Kettering, England. Quite a nostalgic place. Now, I've never been there, but I saw Braveheart, and I did Google it, and there's a lot of nice things to do there. You might not know this about her, but she was once hairdresser for Queen Elizabeth. She once dated Paul McCartney's neighbor's baby sister's older brother, and she was the muse behind the rock opera Bohemian Rhapsody. Again, Sarah has fallen victim to the generated introduction, so please welcome our next evaluator, Sarah Hunt.
Thank you, General Evaluator, fellow Toastmasters, our guests, and especially Tony. This was an inspirational speech, the greatest gift. And that one gift was love. That relates to everyone, because that's something given, we all have it. And the question that I immediately thought was, well, how? And that's where the speech started. So going into some examples that points out, well, how does Tony use this gift? The vocabulary and descriptives were beautiful. Precious, glorious, extraordinary. It makes that word gift very precious, very personally unique. And glorious being high lifting just led to the right lead in to the examples. The two stories that are memorable are Jonathan and then the diversity piece to our club. I will say a recommendation on the story about Jonathan. For those that I wasn't here when this major disruption, I have no idea what character you were. You seem lovely now.
Thank you.
It borderlines a bit of a roast, so I'd recommend polishing it so it could support the message that you wanted. I really like the diversity and just mapping out all the different representation of our club. We're a mini example of what we and you expect that we take out to the world. And I thought that was the best part of your speech. I love the simplicity is one gift. We have many talents, but to have that one gift, we could really hone in and think about, well, how am I going to use that? How does it relate? I was thinking, well, I have my family and my people I work with, my neighbors, this community. So I like the simplicity and the clarity of how you delivered the speech. I would have liked to have seen you come out behind the lectern. I noticed this, you had used your fist and you were really trying to point your points out. I like that. I wanted to see there was something maybe in the left side that you were doing, I wouldn't have seen it. But to inspire, I need to see some more body language and less use of notes, and you could do that by stepping outside. And I think you knew your speech. You had those words didn't just, I don't think came from, some of it might have been impromptu, but you prepared this speech. So I would have liked to have seen those recommendations, but what a fantastic, uplifting, inspirational speech. So thank you for sharing your greatest gift and pouring out that love to our club. Mr. General Evaluator.
Thank you, Sarah. We had three speeches, so we got three evaluators. Our next evaluator has been a Toastmaster for 18 years. Thanks to Toastmasters, Tim has been employed by Tony Robbins and has authored 17 books. Please welcome our VP of Membership and his evaluation all this evening, Tim Rickey.
This speech is a dramatic talk. But the objectives here are not dramatic. This leads you to a lot of confusion here. I think of something dramatic reading Shakespeare or reading The Raven in one of our clubs. But this was more of a training session, but the way they described it, you did it just as you should, but their description, I feel, is wrong in here. So here's some of
the, well, there you go.
It isn't. So we're going to put you in a very liberal position where we're locked in one. It's up to you to take it where you wish to. I'm going to try and address all of these suggestions, which indicated that the audience was entertained. And of course, Stephen adds those little touches of humor, and then he also has the ability to feed off remarks out of, well, like maybe Jonathan might make a remark. I get very nostalgic about that. Describe dramatic impact on the audience. I've never seen anybody do PowerPoint so flawlessly, except when he got to the end, I'd already written this down, about going through PowerPoint. Most people, when I've seen presentations, I don't care who it is, if Tony Robbins or anybody else, something goes wrong. But not tonight. It was just that one reverse one, and we had to go back. He got back quickly. So applaud you on that. Can you see yourself? You ask us. Would be a good question you could ask us when it comes to vivid images. And also, you could use some cartoons or photos in there. I saw a presentation a few weeks ago that was nothing but photos. But it made you think. It put yourself into those photos. So it might be something to be considered for future speeches. Then, how did the speaker use vocal variety, body language, and facial gestures? Well, Steve, you're excellent at that. There's nothing lacking there at all. You implanted and put those points in place by using those items within your speech. Perhaps asking directly to the individual, how do you see yourself as one of these items on here, might be helpful, so that you can put yourself into their place. And the last one was, how did the speaker build a powerful dramatic close? Well, you had a close, but it wasn't very dramatic. One thing I suggest to these speakers that I've worked with in contests is repeat your close twice in two different vocal varieties. Make it softer and then make it strong. So you know it's ending, you know the point's done. Those two things. So the suggestion I'd make are two things I make in almost every speaker I know of. Pause. This is supposed to be a dramatic speech. The pause puts you in the dramatic position. And the other is passion. If you feel these things are needed, I want to know about it. How do you feel about that? I want to hear it. Mr. Master Evaluator.
Thank you, Tim. Madam Timer, may we get a timer's report for our three evaluators this evening?
You sure may. Charlie spoke for 3 minutes and 5 seconds. He qualifies. Sarah for 2 minutes, 59 seconds. She qualifies. And Tim, 2 minutes and 52 seconds, so he also qualifies. Everyone qualifies this evening for voting.
Okay, please vote for best evaluator, and also you can vote for most improved Toastmaster this evening as well.
Did you say everybody qualified?
Yes, everyone qualified.
Okay, just making sure because I didn't check all that up for the
year. I have a couple of notes about the meeting in general. Jonathan, as Toastmaster, did a good job pointing out the agenda changes at the beginning of the meeting. Also, keeping an eye on the clock and letting us shift from table topics, whether we needed to add more or remove a couple to keep us on time. So he kept us in line the whole meeting. That was good. Also, he explained to our guests the portion of the voting.
Sir.
and filling out the slips, which is good. A lot of times we lose track of guests don't always know everything that goes on in the meeting, so we need to take these opportunities to fill you in so you can be included and you feel like you have an idea of what to do and how to participate in the meeting as well. Also, I love coming to these meetings because, like Tony said in her speech, we have such a diverse club, and every time I hear these guys speak, I learn so many things about it. Tony, I know you have a desire to save the planet, so I'm going to call you Captain Planet from now on for some reason. I don't know why, but I like that. And Stephen, I didn't know that you were only interested in the newsletter, so that year. Other than that, the meeting in general was very good. This was our first meeting of the year, so plus we just came off a two-week hiatus, so kind of getting back into the swing of things. That was the meeting in general. We have some other functionaries we need to get our closing reports on. So Roy, we'll start with you. Can you give us a recap of the grammarian?
I thought everybody used the word of the day, except, excuse me if I missed it, Jason, Susan, sorry, guest. Susan, and then what? Did you use it? Okay. I'll do some more here. Colorful imagery, a couple things I picked up. Sweetest part of life is rooted in the heart, even though I'm a guy, that really touched my soul. Tony, I liked your comment about love without being overbearing. I laughed out loud about that. And then, of course, let there be love in the world, let it start with me. That's really all I picked up. I didn't have any issues or problems on anybody's grammar. Thank you.
Now, serving in multiple personalities this evening, Emma, do you have to report on two things? You can choose which one you want to go and report on.
She just reports the offhand.
So just report the offhand.
I'm still working on things. But the offhand report I can do real quick.
Want to ask Susan to
I didn't catch a lot of things because I'm concentrating on the two roles here. So I might not have caught things. I might have caught things that I thought were there but weren't. So, that's going to happen. Tony, I caught at one point 3 double clutches and 4 ands, I think. Steven, a couple of ands. Jay, 1 double clutch and 5 ands, I believe. Sarah, 2 ands, or possibly maybe one of them might be a so. Susan, mom. It feels really weird to call her that in here. 4 ands. Roy didn't catch anything. Tim, I caught 1 double clutch and 3 ands. Charlie, 1 and. ET, 2 double clutches. And Jason?
Jason.
Okay, good. I got your name right. And I got 3 ums and 1 and. That's really good. I always go, and me, I got a whole bunch of stuff. I'm not even going to mention it because, I mean, I failed in a lot of captions.
You'll get there.
So that is my report for
tonight. All right, thank you very much. Since we're still tabulating votes, I'd like this opportunity to go back to our guests once more and just tell us what you thought of the meeting in general and give us some feedback, because just like our speakers, we'd like to hear feedback from you as well. So Jason, would you stand up and give us a recap?
Sure. I thought it was great. It was a great meeting. Everyone had a really, really good, powerful story that I think emotionally you can connect with and take some positive feedback to apply to yourself. So just on a scale of connecting and bettering yourself, I think it was great as part of the support group. But I learned a lot from y'all, how you speak, how you use your hands, stories you use. The evaluators did a great job and it helped me really connect with. The next time I do a speech, maybe I'll do 1, 2, 3. Take that and use it as best practice. So just being the first time being here, I took a lot away, and I think it was great. You all did a great job. So thank you.
Hope you come back.
And E.T.
I was very comfortable, too. I was very comfortable here. I am looking at part to get out and socialize and be here in Florida, meet new people to learn also. I was surprised that I learned as much as I did.
about which things have been properly. One thing I think I would like to see a little more is if someone already speaks a paragraph up there, I would like to see them speak. I get so aggravated on television. Well, I was a councilman local. When I see politicians on television that are experts on this subject, supposedly, they're going to speak for 45 seconds, they got to read every word. If they don't know the subject, but anyways, I enjoyed this a lot. I learned a lot from the forum.
Yeah. We appreciate your feedback, and our VP of membership will probably be touching base with you at some point in the near future to follow up with you. The agenda for next week is floating around somewhere. Do you know where it's at? Okay.
I have it. Okay, for next week, we do not have a Toastmaster yet. Anybody?
No. Nobody can sign up on the
I have Mark for the 20th and Jay for the 27th. I don't have anyone for the 13th.
Well, you can move me from the 20th. Well, yeah, if you want to move me, I'll do that.
Move it to next week instead?
If you want me to.
And I can take up the one on the 27th. Yeah. That would work.
If you want to do
the 13th, I may or may not be here. It depends. It's Stephen's birthday. And
okay, well, do you want to do that then? Move me.
I'll be here.
So, do I need to go on easy speaking? Do that then?
I can do it for you.
Okay.
So, I'll put Jay down as Toastmaster.
Do you have a subject, Jay?
I don't.
Okay.
And I'll put my name down for the 27th. Okay. So, for next week, we have John Dunn and Timothy Bricky as speakers. We have room for one more if anyone wants to join. Table topics is Charlie. We need a general evaluator. We need two more evaluators, and Tony will be an evaluator. We need a supervisor of elections. We need a grammarian and a timer. Roy will be the off counter. So keep those in mind. Jay, you might want to particularly keep that in mind, see if you can get some people. Like I said, I'm not sure if Stephen and I will be available. Emma is in school this next semester, so she will not be available. And so please just let us all know. And then we have Mark is going to be the 20th, and we have Sarah as a speaker. Tim as the table topics master, Tony as the general evaluator, and Roy as an evaluator, and Jay as a grammarian. So we're getting really good on the next session too.
Well, the 13th, you weren't able to go in and sign up. When I was in Easy Speak, the 13th, for some reason, was blocked out. So we couldn't sign up.
I fixed that.
But when I was in there, I couldn't do it.
Yes. All right. So yeah, I kind of messed up.
So if people can go on and sign up for the 13th, please.
Yeah, please do that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
One of the things we'd like to do is get people signed up as early as possible into the next week, so we can work on our introductions and everything like that. It helps the meetings flow more smoothly, and also helps us work on our leadership skills.
Absolutely.
Yes, Tony.
Mark.
Yes.
I thought you were going to refer to me as Captain Planet.
I will.
Okay. My birthday is this month.
Woo!
There's a big party planned. It's the 27th, it's a Wednesday. So I invite you all to come over to a late dinner with me. My compliments of me and my mom. And whoever's here, love to have you at a party.
And you get your first pan?
I'm paying!
God, I'm
first
calling
I'm
that
paying. Did she I gets, pay for that big party
first,
last year?
She gets her first check, right?
Oh, I've been getting checks. That's my only
job. When was that? 20th?
27th? Yeah, well, but I'm refinancing my house, and I'll be saving like $40,000, so we will party.
Wow. Yay!
We'll party.
Tony.
Okay, the votes are in. The winners, the first winners of 2016. Best Speaker Award tonight is presented to...
Captain Earth.
The next award is our Best Table Topics Award. Tonight, it's a rare treat that we give this award to E.T. Tonight, I'm giving to a person that took on two roles because it's hard to do two roles. And we don't want her to go away empty-handed after all. So please return to the lectern to receive the first recipient of Tim Chastain 2016, Emma Hancock! Woo! Schedule a planning session meeting.
Yes.
And you guys won't be here next Wednesday.
Probably not.
So we need to come up with a solution because a lot of us aren't available on the weekends outside of the training that we're doing.
We also
get
a Wednesday.
Well, I'm in favor of having it Wednesday after our meeting, and what we started last year as officers was to end the meeting at 8. We can still have a very productive, very good meeting, and then we can, you know, not have a long, or, you know, if it goes an hour or whatever, it's not terribly inconvenient. And then if we don't finish, we can do it again.
Can we do it Wednesday without Susan and Stephen if we get their information?
We really need Susan, don't you think?
Yeah.
Yeah. And, well, and today is a good time to ask people what they're working on.
We can talk about it tonight, and we can email each other.
Okay, well, I would just suggest all the members, you know, if you know you're going to finish a communication or a leadership project, we have the obviously information from the start of the year. Some people are not no longer here. We've got spots we need to fill in, so we need to find out what your goals are. I know Sarah turned in an advanced communication. I just turned in a basic communication. We've got, and maybe leadership, or I can finish a leadership. But if we've got that all designed out, it helps Susan manage what we're doing in the club, and it also gives us points with the area, with the outside leadership, to achieve
their
goals.
So can we push this off to the 20th?
I don't think that's a problem. I mean, and we're all, you've got a group of experienced officers. Yeah. I would just say, Susan, for the 20th.
Okay. We can fill in, we'll fill in a lot of the blanks between now and then, so the 20th is...
Yeah.
Okay. Does anybody have any other last minute announcements? Okay. Meeting adjourned.